sanitation issues through data and through low-cost solutions. So that is what we have been doing for 4 years.
So it's been very modest. So it's been rated as amongst the top people by Forbes India under 30. Okay. So, you know, and he is also an Ashoka Fellow. So how many of you familiar with Ashoka? So yeah, he's an Ashoka Fellow as well. And he's also a fellow at MIT DSW. A big welcome to you, Kuldeep. So Sujay, you want to introduce yourself with that?
Hi, I'm Sujay, Santra. Founder and CEO at iKure. Before starting this venture, I was working in IBM at Oracle for close to 12 years in 2010. So, as many of you believe, I'm not a doctor, I'm a doctor.
Good. Once again, Sujay is being very modest about himself. So, he's one of those very successful people who has a solution architect at Oracle. Decided to stop taking money. I'm joining the social enterprise world. He's also an Ashoka Fellow, and he has been interviewed by CNBC-TV18 in a program called Young Turks. And he's also been MIT has a forum called MTech India, and he has participated in conversations on energy. And he's also rated as NDTV Good Samaritan for the year 2013. A big welcome.
My name is Shiban Ganju, and I'm a physician by training. I work with an organization called Siva Mother. We do metabolic giant on the induction and plus other programs.
Okay. So, once again, you have a very, very modest speaker. So, Dr. Shiban has been working for 4 decades as a doctor, and a very interesting thing in him is he's also been a major in the Indian Army. And he moved to Chicago, he's been a doctor for several years. And he was also the CEO of Reliance Healthcare. And he has worked with more than 100 non-profit projects in his entire career. He has been an advisor to Rajiv Gandhi Charitable Foundation and the Indian American Foundation. A big, big welcome. So my next speaker is Mr. Sai Damodaran. You have the honor of introducing yourself.
Welcome to all. Damodaran, coming from an office called Gramalaya, the NGO from Tamil Nadu, and we've been associating with Deshpande Foundation over the last 2 years. And our main focus is only for water sanitation and hygiene services. So far, we have promoted more than 184,000 toilets in 5 southern states in India. Thank you so much.
Thank you once again. I think something that we need is also pretty modest. I think one of his passions is to have 10 million households with toilets by the year 2020. So a big, big warm welcome to you. Then I want to introduce you to the couple of expert respondents. Dr. Sundar Kamat, you want to introduce yourself?
I'm in the field of electronics manufacturing. Based in San Jose, California. And we recently opened a plant in Chennai, India, to help with the Make in India program. And one of my other passions is what's called as the hygiene release program, where we take all this that's been developed and implemented to create a holistic, sustainable village.
Good. So once again, I have a very, very modest speaker. So Dr. Sundar has more than 12 patents to his name. And he's got more than 50 journal conference presentations, and he's a senior vice president of Sanmina. Sanmina does outsourcing contract manufacturing for hardware vendors. Like for example, most of your phones, etc., are manufactured by companies like Sanmina. A big welcome to you, Sujay. So the last speaker is Dr. Shelly Batra. Once again, an extremely modest speech. So she's called Miss or Mrs. Tuberculosis. That's my nickname for you. I guess it's the same way of calling you. So she was called as the Entrepreneur of the Year in year 2014 by by Schwab Foundation and World Economic Forum and Ashoka Changemaker, another one, three in the title, and a Penguin published author. She's got a book published by Penguin, and she has lectured in two schools, one of which I have a problem with, which is the University of Chicago. I went to a competing school, so that's a bit of a problem, but we're going to
learn.
And Harvard School of Public Health. A big, big welcome to Dr. Shelly. So the format of this panel is as follows. So each of the panelists will present for about 10 minutes, starting with Kuldeep. And there are four presentations, and then we will have some discussion. I'll let the audience ask questions, and I'll ask a few myself, and we'll go back and forth. So Kuldeep, it's all yours.
I'm probably the only non-doctor or the non-medical person in this panel. So I'll be trying to talk about a very fundamental unit when it comes to water and sanitation, and specifically in schools, because we have about 10 to 11 million schools, government schools in India. And one of the biggest problems, apart from quality education, is a lack of good toilet facilities, which in effect affects the learning outcomes, but also directly or indirectly affects the health outcomes. So I take you through this process of how we have gone about trying to solve this problem in a very fundamental way, where scale did not play a very big role, and now how we might go about scale. So I'll take you through this process. So if you go to a typical school, say in Bangalore or Hubli government school, the first big problem is that a bad toilet is no longer a problem itself. The students, the management have gotten used to the fact that a bad toilet is okay. You learn to live with it. So then what you do? The students start going outside the school and things like that. So we have come with a process wherein we take students through a gamified process. First we make them discover the problem itself, because they become so apathetic to the problem that if they see urine around their classroom, they're okay with it. If there is no water supply to the school, it's okay. If the toilet is being vandalized, they're okay. If the girls are not attending the school because of toilets, it's okay. So first you kind of discover the problem itself, and you make them discover through their own ways, rather than going there with a sense of entitlement and saying, I think toilet is very important and you need to have it. After they discover, you make them investigate. So we have come up with basic tools wherein the students start collecting data. Data about the source of water, the drainage, how the toilet is being used. And in this investigation, we have realized a lot of simple issues. For example, 60% of the toilets we have surveyed in Bangalore, in Bangalore city, which is about 800 schools, we realized that most of the girls do not come to the school because of the toilet. And one of the biggest problems is government schools are sources of vandalism. So you would very, very surprisingly find holes at the doors. You would find that the functionality of the door is not there because privacy is in a way violated, and therefore the girls don't use the toilet. Or simple things like, for example, even if there is a proper door, but the girls do not use the toilet because a latch would be missing. So when the girl squats, her dupatta touches the ground, and that in a way starts touching the ground, and to avoid that, girls don't go to the toilet. So we have collected a lot of granular information, and now these students, using postcards and WhatsApp, have started reporting to us on the situation in the school on a month-on-month basis. And in that way, we have also involved a lot of neighborhoods and things like this. After we investigate, we solve. So we look for solutions which are there out there in the market, or we co-develop solutions with the students itself. It is very, very important that when we talk about sanitation, the conversation or narrative is let's build 50 lakh toilets. But it's a behavioral problem. You can have the toilet, but the student might not be using it. Right? or you don't have the toilet and the student does not know how to use it. So this one size fits all approach that I go fix a toilet and then everybody will magically start using it is very, very foolhardy to believe. We have to come up with a solution which is far more holistic in nature. And finally, what we have done is over the years, since we have collected a lot of information, we have started taking this information and giving it to government officials. We have started giving this information about toilet conditions to other problem solvers, and we have come up with a few solutions with them. So this is our process. And the most important stakeholder is the child himself or herself. So they are involved in the building of the toilet in a way and in managing, maintaining and reporting. So that's the process. So this is, like I mentioned, that you know, we have realized that we have taken toilet as the centerpiece of our work, and we are working on behavioral change, co-developing solutions, but we have also tried a very interesting model called as reward-based financing. So what we do is we map what the school management and the teacher is looking for, and if the school is maintaining the systems over a period of time, it's mapped with the reward what the school would be getting. So it could be water filter, it could be a playground, it could be things like this. So in a way we are incentivizing it for the schools to do it, and we are seeing a lot of traction in that as well. This is one such solution, and I'll just take you through this journey. And this is probably an example of a frugal solution which has come from the community itself. So 3 years back we go to a government school, and we realize that the boys have a wall, that's the only urinal. So the boys walk in, urinate anywhere on the wall and go back. And of course they don't have footwear and things like that. So one model was you go look for funds, build a proper toilet. 40 to 50% of the schools, even if the toilets are built, the toilets are blocked. Because maintenance is a very big issue. And if the toilet is very, very good, then the management locks it and they use it only when they want to use the toilet. So most of the toilets, including Hubli, you find the principal and the teachers using the toilet, but it's the access for the students is limited. So we started thinking of a solution which is frugal. All of you have seen a 20-liter water can. So we cut that water can in the shape of a urinal. We placed a table tennis ball here. And in a way, we built a waterless urinal. So what the table tennis ball did, since the urine would go, the ball would come up. The urine would allow for the flow of urine. The ball would simply cut the supply of air and in a way negate odor. That was a very important thing. The second thing we also started doing, the students started doing, was they started using oil from excess vegetable oil from hotels or oils in mechanic shops and things like that, to peel away the layer to the urine so that urine just slips through and goes there directly. So when we started going there, we were told that it's a plastic bottle and it will get vandalized. It's lasted for about a year, year and a half. And now that there is confidence, we have come up with a do-it-yourself urine. So this is a DIY kit which would not take more than 5 to 6 minutes to install in a government school using a tin-based material, a zinc-based material. So this is a tin which takes about 3 minutes to kind of set it up and you know install it in a school. So this is a very simple intervention which has come to the community. Now we're working on urinals for girls as well. But what is very exciting is when we took this information and exposed it to people, now we have had companies like Cisco building simple sensors with us so that we can start giving real-time usage of when is the toilet being used and when it's not being used. And we have come up with simple behavioral hacks. What happens is when the midday meal comes, all the boys are sent to the toilet. If you just stagger that for every 15 minutes, grade 6 and 7 goes, and the next 15 minutes, grade 8 and 9 goes, then the place is not under too much pressure and stress. So now a lot of experiments are going on where we are using sensors to track usage, but we are also trying to use sensors and see if the water consumption of the students when they are in school is high, because urine could be one of the indicators of water consumption, not the only indicator. So these are some of the tests we are doing. But this is a simple example of how a frugal innovation from the communities going bottoms up. Now this is scaled up to about 200 schools in Bihar, tribal Maharashtra, Rajasthan, where we have no access at all. So other NGOs have gotten in touch with us. And technology is helping us report problems real time and kind of work on it in a more crowdsourced and a collective manner. So this is how we are working on water and sanitation with probably the most important stakeholder in the system who is often ignored, which is the student. And this is about that. Thank you very much.
Respect.
impact. So, for example, we initially the data was very, very qualitative in nature, wherein the students, the teachers, the principals kind of reported it, then they got third-party organizations to report it. Now we're using sensor data to kind of validate the fact that they're going to the toilet again and again. So that's one. The second thing we want to do, which is the second phase, is how can we now use this and make the school as a belief center and improve health, hygiene, and education. So this becomes a starting point, where in a way, it's sometimes very difficult to slot our organization. Are we into water and sanitation, or are we into student-led innovation solving real problems? So that's how we want to build on this. The second thing regarding the cost, a set of 5 urinals would not cost more than 6,000 rupees. 5,000 to 6,000 rupees. And why this number is important is, even a school management committee can come and give you this amount. So anybody working in government schools can tell you that the government school will never pay money for any service. Right now, Hubli, we have worked with 50 schools, and we have got 35 schools to pay us for this, which is a very, very big feat, because if the government school is paying, the customer is paying for the product itself. The second thing is, now because the government school is paying, we have had corporates who have come forward and have said, we will help in the maintenance. So we will take care of the maintenance and we will reach the scale which you have been looking for. And you give us the app where it will start also reporting how it's being maintained or not. So that's how, from a scale and the financial point of view, we are looking
at. Good afternoon, all of you. So, iKure is a social enterprise which is. iKure is a social enterprise which is providing affordable and accessible healthcare delivery to the last mile using technology innovations. And as I was mentioning before starting this journey, I was a techie working in IBM Oracle, last Oracle as a solution architect. And what actually was the cause behind starting iKure was a couple of things. We have seen that there is a huge demand in the supply gap when it comes to healthcare, and especially in the rural health space, for every one doctor we have, you know, for every 2,000 patients we just have one doctor. And with the ever growing increase in the population, we will never be able to, you know, bridge this gap unless and until we use technology. So at iKure, when we started in 2009, the initial concept started, and then in 2010, we built on our technology platform. From my experience, what I have seen is, whenever a patient is coming to a hospital to see a doctor, and then all the registration, billing, and everything comes into play. And whenever the patient is walking out of the hospital, the patient loses all contact with the doctor. Why is that? The entire epicenter of the healthcare are the patients. And in this, we are not able to, you know, focus and see the flow of the patient right from the last mile. So at iKure, we have built on this model, wherein right from the last mile, wherein the patients are there, from there, the initiation of that, to the clinics, wherein the patients will be able to see the GP cases, the doctors are there, and then they can be sent to the hub hospitals for any secondary with the tertiary care. This entire flow of these patients can be tracked and monitored using our system, which we call as WHIMS, Wireless Health Incident Monitoring System, which we have built our own proprietary cloud-hosted management solution. So in the initial days of 2010, 11, and 12, we spent a lot of time understanding on the ground what works, what why it does not work. We have seen that the technology has impacted during that time, that in all spheres of our life, but not healthcare. Why is that? That kind of process came to our mind. And then when we wanted to understand, being from Oracle, we were thinking that we have some fantastic solutions that we are giving off to US, Europe, and other countries. Why such solutions are not being adopted in the Indian context? And then we understood that in India, the situation, the terrain, the infrastructure, the name people are very different than the US counterpart. In India, we had to do a bottom-up approach. Even in today's Deshpande Foundation Development Dialogue, we have seen several people talking about that the way we need to come up with the solutions has to be bottom-up driven, where we understand the challenges on the ground with respect to infrastructure, the main people who are there on the ground, and how we can build on that.
Excuse me.
Yeah. When I say last mile healthcare, it means absolutely last mile. We have the patients who are there across the river without a bridge, on top of the hill, without through the forest. So from the last mile, absolutely last mile, we have been able to serve the patients using native intervention. So next slide, I'll just. So how we started is on a hub and spoke model. So initially the way that it works is in the year 2012, after building on the technology, we were depending on various governments and NGOs, and we figured it out that just technology is not good enough to create the right kind of impact. And then we started on a healthcare model, which is a one window approach, meaning that we set up clinics in the rural villages, which is a one window approach. The patients come in, they get physical doctor consultation, medicines, various tests being done, such as BP, ECG, sugar test being done. In case the patient needs access to secondary and the tertiary care, they can be sent to various hospitals. And then we have understood that using this model, we are able to develop a hub and spoke model. So I will give an example of Torpa in Jharkhand, where we are operating. This block comprises around 96,000 tribal population. Tata Trust and Pradhan have been working in this area for the last 15 to 20 years, providing livelihood and women empowerment and other facilities. And what they have seen is, just because healthcare is not available, more than 50% of their savings of these people are getting lost. But very basic things, be it malaria or any other thing, these patients are being asked to pay anywhere between 3,000 to 5,000 rupees. As part of this collaboration, we have started, where we have set up the hub, which is in the middle of Torpa town. And then we have this mobile medical team, which goes around in these locations 3 days in a week. Let's say on Mondays, they will go to village A, where they will be sitting from morning 9 a.m. to 12 noon. They will be seeing all the patients coming from these deeper locations. And out of, let's say on that day, they see 50 patients. Out of that, maybe 5 to 10 patients need some follow-up. Then we have these community health workers who are none other than the members picked up from the community, mostly women in the age range of 20 to 45, 50 years of age. They have the smartphones and the medic bags. They capture all the writings and other details, so they act as the interface between the doctors and the patients on the other days. And then in the hubs, we have got various other facilities such as the pathology and telemedicine, and now we are launching various other services. So in the last 6 years of our journey, we have served in 6 states, serving 3.5 million population, serving various other healthcare deliveries. And one of the important facts that we have seen is, in rural area, if you just think that just the unavailability of the doctors and the medicines are the problems, actually that is not. We have been able to deal with various other social, cultural and other barriers, where we have seen that even if the doctors are prescribing iron and folic acid, the patients won't be consuming that. And through various converting innovation by linking water with nutrition and nutrition with health, we have been able to provide a very holistic healthcare delivery. And our approach is, initially whenever we enter a new area, we do a needs assessment study, then we offer various kinds of services, being on mother and child, GP services, telemedicine, because even within India, every state has its own set of challenges. So once we get to understand those challenges, we work on the unit model, because ours is a sustainable healthcare delivery model. Once this unit model works, then we are able to scale it up and bring various other
services. In a country where the doctor-patient ratio is highly skewed, telemedicine could be the solution. What I like about the model was, it's not telemedicine alone. It's the mind medicine and a very strong medical system, which is the backbone of a good medical system. If you do not refer in time, you lose a patient. If you do not recognize, this is postpartum in which the mother will die. So I think that component has been built in effectively. So now I just have one question for you. How have you made it sustainable? And do you think you will maintain your sustainability when you go to sleep?
In our model, in our revenue model, we have several revenue models in place. For example, the patients on a transaction mode, they are paying 90 rupees for doctor consultation and medicine. We have something called as health cards, so I'll just show you the health cards. So these health cards are QR code based cards, wherein the health worker, they can go to these patients' home, they have the smartphones, and once they scan these, the data, they are able to see the entire patient's record, they are able to enter the vitals. These health cards cost only 600 rupees per family per year, which patients' revenue, we are selling technology to various NGOs and other governments. Like we have data analytics, we have CRM solutions, wherein once the health worker or any caregiver are going to the last mile, we will be able to capture what kind of essential products that they have, and that is built into the system. And then we also earn revenue through other government and other mechanisms. This is how we have made the model.
Your technology is a for-profit expansion.
I belong to an organization called Save a Mother. I proposed to show no slides. I sent them so that they could prepare the questions and not the show the slides. And my approach, I'm a physician by training. So I've worked in trenches all my life. I work in the tertiary hospitals. I still practice. So my approach to healthcare is very different. What do the citizens want? How do you keep this class of 100 people healthy for the next 50 years? What are the demand side interventions that you take? Again, it's ignored because there is no profit in there. So we work on the demand side of healthcare, this barrel, no man's land between the doctor and the patient's home, which is the area that nobody's covered and nobody wants to cover. So we work with communities to make it simple. And the cheapest, the least expensive way of keeping people healthy is changing the mindset. You can decrease the disease burden by 25 to 45% or maybe even 50% if you just change the way you think. It's as simple as that. It can cost nothing. Otherwise, those many people end up in clinics, starting their journey from primary to secondary to tertiary, depending on what their disease is. Now, if anybody has a question, what are the statements that I'm making are based on data? I don't want to bore you with statistics and data. We have healthcare experience in the world for almost 150 years now. So this data is from various countries and various experiences that we have, and that's why I'm translating it into this. So how do we, what do we do then? How do we change the mindset? We've taken a model based on religions of the world, armies of the world that are able to change people's minds. They do stupid things in the name of something out there. Be the armies or the religions of the world. So what we done, how do we apply the new knowledge to mankind for the last 5,000 years for healthcare? The four things the religions do. Number one is a promise of reward or punishment. I underline the word promise. It's a promise. Number two, they convert their knowledge into simple slogans and songs. Number three, they repeat these slogans and songs ad infinitum. You name it, they have an occasion. There's a Tuesday or a Sunday or a Friday, the message that delivered to you. Lastly, there is no endpoint. None of the religions have declared that we're going to end in 2025. So these four things are extremely important when you get to the behavior modification thing for healthcare. We change the mindset of people, employees, corporate bodies, for that matter, anyone except the children at home. They're not anywhere for behavior modification. So we apply this in healthcare. Reward and punishment is right there. If you follow these instructions, you will live healthy, you don't follow, you will die. It's very simple. In cases of maternal care, it happens in 9 months. You listen to me, you will live, you don't listen to me back. And the result is there, the whole community wakes up that their parents are saying right. Number two, we have compressed every book that we deliver to the people in the 5 slogans. We have an instruction, not all the 5 bullet points to be delivered to the community. Then we convert these bullet points to songs and slogans. The community writes their own songs, the lyrics, based on these 5-6 points, and they sing, and they repeat. To give an idea of what I mean by repetition, in Ladakh, where we worked in 167 villages, in the year 2014, we participated in 10,000, close to 10,000 public meetings. So it's an intense work. It's not, even now, with Ladakh man, while he's a Ladakh man program manager, we had Nizamabad man,
vision. And Prashant Rupal and the board for the Deshpande fellows. And this is the data from there. The 10,000 meetings delivering these messages again and again and again. Do we have an endpoint? Answer is no. We're experimenting with certain things. I'll explain to you in a minute. What do we have an endpoint? Now, what is the impact of all this? I just want to use some numbers now. Tell you how impressive this is. The maternal mortality rate is described as numbers of mothers that die in childbirth per 100,000 or 1 lakh childbirths. That's the definition. When we started this program in Gadag about 5 years ago, the maternal mortality rate in the government data was about 400. Our baseline survey also showed the same thing. Our maternal mortality data for the past 1 year, this is incorrect data, I told you data driven. In the last year till January to December 2016 is 25. Only one mother has died in the last 18 months in all 167 villages. I was shocked with the cost. Our cost per capita is less than 15 rupees per year. Cost per village is less than 15,000 rupees per year. I can do the whole country for 600 crores, give it to me and I'll do it to you. And we promise 90% deliverables are 90% decrease in maternal mortality, 60% decrease in neonatal mortality. Puerperal detection rate goes up by 3 to 10%. Contraceptive acceptance goes up by 10%. Under 18, child marriage almost disappears. This is the deliverables for 15 rupees per capita per year. All of work is less than 25 cents in non-translated. Now, scalability. I want to talk about scale now. Scale is two ways in healthcare. One is geographic scale, that one area, second area, third area, fourth area, but much more scale than that. Because you are dealing with people, human beings. Human beings don't just come to you at delivery time, that's an entry strategy. They have the same problems. So, I will save 15 rupees per capita. We also will deliver tuberculosis control, we'll also deliver population stabilization, we'll also deliver immunization, we'll also deliver you name it. So within those 15 rupees, because you create a platform of people who are volunteers, who are community-based people, they're interested in keeping their themselves healthy, their house healthy, their street healthy, their village healthy, they come and volunteer, they come in droves, trust me. We don't have a problem in finding volunteers. In UP, in Amethi district, where we started this program in 2008, we have trained close to 30,000 health volunteers, out of which 3,000 are very active. So we promote from the bottom. Now, mind you, these health volunteers are not paid. It's only the good ones among them, we call them the swasthakis. They're paid a little. From the swasthakis, we promote to the field officers. They paid a little more. Our top management is free. The mid-venture health finance is going, the care and the cure follows that. It's a profit book as simple as that, money making wise. So how do you structure healthcare finance for the poorest of the poor? We don't know. Nobody's done it before. We know how to care healthcare finance for the rich. It's an insurance model. Very simple. Pay me the premium, I'll pocket 50% in my pocket, and rest 50% will spend on your healthcare, so to speak, as an insurance model. But how do you structure healthcare finance for the poorest of the poor who don't have the ability to pay? So how much money is optimal money to be spent to keep a poor man alive till age 67, which is the data from last century, to keep people alive with a minimal intervention till 67? Thank you.
It's also a clinical thing. For example, what I've heard is generally mortality is excessive eating is a big cause of less dying, food is not controlled. But that's a very good cycle and that's the key that we're losing the most of the use. So one aspect of clinical cycle is
National Health Mission is ubiquitous, omnipotent, is available everywhere now. Almost all villages are penetrated in National Health Mission. There is components to that, I don't want to belabor the point, but a woman has to deliver in an institution.
and they get paid for that. The woman gets paid, the doctor gets paid, the transporter gets paid, the incentive is given even the motivator. For everybody, the change is paid by the government. Patient doesn't pay, it's the reverse now. So they incentivize. In our areas where we work, institution deliveries are for 98%. We do not take care of institution delivery ourselves. We provide no clinical work because that is too complex. Just the behavioral modification, as I said, we have no need to resuscitate those women who bleed too much because we're already taken care of. Prashant will tell you, we frankly women, every pregnant woman, every pregnant. So we have ways of doing it without owning you, but we track people, every woman. We then classify them high risk, mid risk, low risk, and we follow high risk a little more, and we treat them at the local level for the doctor's level.
So I wanted to come in. Two things about your presentation that really appealed to me, and one is the 5-point training for the health workers. Because I've met so many NGOs that they have those huge, comprehensive training manuals. So the message that comes across is that do not overburden your community health workers. You cannot have an overload of information that's not working out. So this 5-point message or 7-point message is really something that is doable and that delivers results. The second thing I like is the measurable impact, as with the other presenters. They are measuring not just outcomes, but long-term impact by measuring the maternal mortality. Now, my question for you is very simple. India is doing so terribly more than maternal mortality, perinatal mortality, unified mortality, the worst, really worse than Bangladesh. How much time would it take for India to reach the level of a drought?
The MDG goals will be done in 5 years from now, or I'll be out of job. We are pretty bad, but not that dismal. If you see the rate of increase of maternal deaths, even by government programs, we should be able to reach MDG goals, Millennium Development Goals, which is supposed to be reached in 2015 by 2020. This is the back of our work, the calculations that are done. So we don't have to be that desperate. Number two, I want to emphasize the point. The misery of India comes from the 200 districts. These 200 districts increase every statistical goal that we have. So we don't have to concentrate all 600 districts. You don't have to go to Chandigarh and Kanpur to do this. You already come above that level. It's 200 districts alone. We have the 80 of them in Bihar and UP. So if you change UP, you change the statistics of the whole world. Most of the misery of the world lives in UP. That's what we have. We want to work in UP. Because it's right there, staring in the face. So it's not that difficult once you get into it and concentrate and focus on the populations, not the diseases, and teach them 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 things. The same person is going to be affected by multiple diseases anyway.
Ramalaya is one of the two necessary centers of the Ministry of Drinking Water and Government of India in providing training and technical support to the government of business and NGOs in southern India. And so far, Ramalaya has provided more than 184,000 colleagues in 5 central states, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, and Maharashtra. And the main focus is on 4 components of sanitation. One is providing clean drinking water and sustainable sanitation solutions to the households with toilet facilities. Then personal hygiene behaviors, hand washing soap, right? Then the 4th one is the menstrual hygiene for the adults and girls in the school. So, normally the government toilets are promoted in a only a toilet only model, 4x3 model, so it will be between a smaller model. But we are promoting a smart toilet. Smart toilet means a toilet with bathroom attached, with toilet, 8x4 size, with good ventilation, good ventilation, then with water storage facilities, plus an incinerator for disposal of waste sanitation. How we are working? Normally, the government of India is working to local government offices and where the toilets are considered at the local level using the subsidy available. But subsidy is not available for every level. So, we really depending on the survey, it takes 122 years to reach India as a open education free nation. So what we are doing, we are letting the microfinance institutions in the world of the banks and central reward in local fund, where we are helping with the local services, what kind of problems should be considered according to the caring and according to the economical status of the region and consumer. Then we are creating demand for community and public sanitation. That means we conduct a meeting of all the villages, then all the villages will be triggered through the increasing meetings. We will talk about the dangers of open education, we will talk about the importance of toilets and personal hygiene. So through that we will create the demand, then we will offer transit solutions for the families to consider it. So the government of India under the search for mission program planning to reach 11 million toilets in the next year by 2019, October 2 on the Gandhiji's 14th birthday anniversary. So this is a very difficult task, and Gramalaya is going to take up 10 million toilets, one tenth of the government of India to the 15 million toilets. For this, we have developed a new strategy called marketing solutions for meeting the demand from the community. So we will identify local NGOs, we will train them, we will capacitate them, we will provide professional support, technical support, and also financial support to build toilets in the ample land. So another, we are planning to reach 100 NGOs in India in the next 3 to 5 years until 2020. Then planning to reach 10 states in India. Currently we have covered 5 states and where we have promoted more than 250,000 toilets, household toilets. And recently we have entered into an agreement in MOU with the government of Pondicherry to declare Pondicherry state as open education free by October 17, 2017, by providing 46,000 household toilets. So we are also motivating the corporates to support our initiatives in sanitation. So how we are addressing that one? Provision of individual household toilets, where corporates can give loan or it can be a part of loan or it can be a reversal subsidy. That money can be used for considering toilets at the village level. The other model is promoting girls-friendly toilet in the schools, where the schools separate toilet facilities for the girls are not available with adequate water facilities and incinerator facilities and also hand washing facilities. And the third one is drinking water facilities for our schools as well as communities. We can also be provided to the population for the country. The fourth one is the open education free village or urban slum, where the CSR funds can be used to care for making a community as 100% toilet covered village with open education free border debate board. So this is one of the targets we have promoted, the Wellbeing. Wellbeing is one of the CSR sponsors. Supported our project in a rural village in Tiruchirappalli in Tamil Nadu, where we have promoted a bottle retention toilet. You can see that really Hindani is having 5 girls. No more, sir. 5 girls is having, 3 of them are adolescent girls. Prior to the toilet, they are all practiced open education. After they got a toilet facility, now they got privacy, safety, and security for their girls and women in their families. So, in that way, we are working, Ramaya is working. Currently, we are looking for more NGOs in North India as well as Southern India as well. So, what we are doing, we are linking with the corporate, we are linking with the donors, we are linking with the banker, we are linking with the microfinance institution. This is a holistic approach we are promoting, and through which we are planning to address more than 100 districts as open education team by 2020 with all of us.
So, when you install the toilet in the neighborhood, what happens to the waste? How is that waste handled? Especially if it is done by taking off sanitation.
Yes,
one more question. Yes. Second one is, what is the typical average cost of putting up?
So, the toilet we promote is the equipment toilet model. It's a realistic model. It's not a conventional model say a toilet. The toilet technology we are promoting, it's not a conventional model like a second tank model. It's a costly model. The target we are promoting is a lease-fit model. It is approved by the UN, United Nations Development Program, as a equipment lease-fit model. The target is considered, it is approved by compound holds in the toilet. So the toilet basically in the first pit. They pick there two pits. One that's a chamber to divert to one pit. One pit is clean, then it diverts from the one pit to another pit. We close the pit for 1 year. Then all the pathogens in the space between so you can remove by hand and then you can use it as a menu for your kitchen garden. There is a model we are promoting. 25 years ago we have promoted more than 5,000 toilet toilets in 1989 to 1994 in Rasipuram municipality, Mukkur municipalities. The toilets we have promoted are still working and people are using and maintaining their toilets. So sustainable toilet models we are promoting. Apart from that, we are also promoting eco-sound toilets, compost toilets, another model for the water aggregator. The third one is we are also concentrating on the people's waste management, where the septic tank cleaners just empty the septic tanks and one of them is filled. Then they just get into the open environment without PTU. So we have developed a new technology called people's waste treatment plant that is funded by Bill Gates Foundation through the IHS in India. Bill Gates has selected in India only one city, that is Kochi city. So we are working under the project for people's waste management project. That's called open DPCP enrollment as well as open discharge period. Cost of the toilet, this cost of toilet is around 15,000 to 18,000. The same model in Karnataka state also, in Rani Metro toilet, in Haveri district, we have promoted more than 340 toilets to the local NGO called VRPS. And the women here are getting loans for consuming the not the subsidy. The subsidy may be available or may not be available for them. More than 340 such toilets are promoted in Haveri district. Through this body foundation support.
Okay, so you are a man with a mission, right? And it's very good. What is very good is not only the scale you achieved, but the scale you plan to achieve. And that is commendable. What I really like is the way you've got other stakeholders on board, the NGOs and the donors and the government and so on. Now, my question for you is, if the toilet costs 15 to 18,000, these people, the householder has to take a loan. Do they have the capacity to pay back? Are you serving those people who do not have the capacity? The poorest of the poor, the tribals, who don't have food to eat? What are you doing?
So we are addressing through the loan form only the middle and bottom of the below the middle level segment only are addressing through loan component. The other families who are the poorest of the poor of the communities, they are being supported through the incentives from the government and also from the central group loan. Is less interest or no interest at all. So that way we are promoting. So overall our approach is cover the entire households in a community 100% toilet cover. Then stop open in peace and ultimately to make it a clean community. That way we are.
Feel free to ask it openly or if you want to target your particular person, don't hesitate to. One thing I want to point out is first question earlier in terms of last mile of healthcare delivery. I don't think they exactly answered that, right? Because if you look at healthcare, the biggest problem is like there's good pharmaceutical medicines, potentially, there's good doctors. But the delivery, which is like taking it to the end patient, which is a very global system. And that's a very global problem and it's definitely much more amplified in India.
So
you
about the 5 points,
you
didn't elaborate on the points.
To me, a writer is one who can expand 5 points in the book. An expert is one who can compress the book into 5 points. For maternal mortality reduction, she's an OB-GYN surgeon, she'll correct me if I'm wrong, there's not much needed. Number one, 3 to 4 antenatal checkups. Point number one, 100 iron folic acid tablets during the pregnancy. Number three, immunization, especially against tetanus. Number four is institutional delivery. Did I miss anything?
Number five,
probably only 4 points. For example, for tuberculosis, early detection, that's what we do, campaigns. We detect them and hand them over to Dr. Batra. That's what we do. only one party, but we do campaigns, our campaigns. And one of the ways of behavioral modification is the following. These little nuggets we learn. And that is, nobody talks about God in Asha shows. I learned a religious practice, I'm not a religious person, but you know, how do they change people in these strange things? Nobody talks about Asha shows. So we don't talk about TV in Asha shows. We go to campaigns. We talk TV as if it is a common goal. There's a hesitation at the beginning, but people with symptoms in campaign will stand up. We have campaigns where 5,000 people will come, 500 people will come, 200 people will come, and we have people who sign up that I look like I have symptoms, I want to get tested. After that, our data showed that there's quite a bit of drop off. So the stigma goes away. And like Dr. Batra was saying this morning, our promoters are the people who have cured of TB. They are our box office stunts. But this is the man who's cured of TB and tells you experience. Then we do this magic shows in the village where the magician puts humor into TB. So everything we compress into 4 or 5 things, and we know exactly what a priest will do in the temple. I'm emphasizing the religious point because tell me another organization that can change behavior of people. That's the reason I'm saying this. And healthcare is so close to religious teachings.
I have questions for all of you, but I will just skip a couple of questions. I really enjoyed all the presentations. First of all, Kuldeep, measuring behavior change has been one of the things you've been grappling with, right? Whether it's behavior change in sanitation, which is especially hard. Sometimes measuring the mortality, for example, you know at the end of it that how many mothers lost their lives, right? Or what the outcomes were. But it's measuring hand washing, for example, right? Or measuring the toilet usage. We've been grappling with how do you indicate us to measure? Do you have any insights or data available? The second thing is, have you measured the impact of your school interventions in their behavior outside of the school? Have they changed behavior at home, for example? Has toilet usage changed at home? That's my question. And second thing, quickly, I'll say what I have to say. For Gramalaya, we have also done an evaluation of the government toilet incentives in Trichy as well. It's one of our districts in particular, Tamil Nadu, Orissa, the Vilayas study. And we found that the contractor builds the toilets as opposed to a household taking the incentive and engaging a mason and bringing it themselves. If the government gives the money to a contractor and doesn't pick up the toilets, right? The quality is bad, satisfaction levels are lower, usage is low, right? So in your model, do you have masons, for example, who go out and build them? Who does the technical part of actually building the toilet?
Actually, behavioral change is very, very difficult. I think the formula he's mentioned, comparing it to the religion, and trying to understand, maybe it works. But in sanitation, what we have been trying to do right now is we've been using technology. So very quickly for us, behavioral changes, we map it in different ways. First, they're unconsciously wrong. They don't even know their usage habits are wrong. They're from unconsciously wrong, how do we get them to consciously wrong? So they know it. So that is where awareness, engagement plays a bigger role. Then from consciously wrong, get up to consciously right. Where they're using the toilet, they're demanding for better maintenance. Because even if you build the toilet, the bigger behavior change there is the maintenance. The problem is not building the toilet. The problem is maintenance. A school management committee does not get more than 12,000 rupees a year. Now, if I'm going to get 12,000 rupees a year, that's roughly 1,000 rupees a month. Expecting them to use the 1,000 rupees a month to maintain the toilet in itself is a very difficult thing. And then finally, you have something that is unconsciously, right? That's when it becomes a real habit, right? So in our case, we've been able to come to the consciously wrong to the consciously right stage. Now, that's where we've opened it. I think the biggest advantage we have seen is in crowdsourcing your ideas. So now what we do is, we use sensors, motion sensors. And also to usage sensors in the urinal itself, and now they're able to say how the usage is before and after. So that's a real-time data point. So
an example is the restroom in here.
Yeah. So if in the restroom here, on the other side, there's one in the men's toilet. While you're washing your hand, it gives you a real-time input of how much of water is being used and things like this. So One data point for us is actual usage itself. The second thing in the community, that's a great question you have asked, what started happening was we started providing students postcards with our address on them. And the students started reporting issues, started reporting the issues to us. And now we have been able to at least improve community toilets and community water tanks. That's what we have been able to do. So in a way, right now, working with the students, we have built a citizen engagement platform wherein as a young citizen in your community, you can demand for better sanitation or you can actually problem solve it yourself. So that's the final stage. But it is very, very difficult. And also the system around does not allow for the changed behavior to get adopted and adapted in a faster way. So I might have a great toilet at school, and as soon as I go home, it's very, very bad. But it's a slow process. So, yes, we have. There has been an increase, but that's where the whole argument is, right? If I talk to people in pedagogy and education, they'll say, how can you link, how can there be direct outcome with attendance increase and toilet usage? There has been better hygiene conditions. But we have that, therefore, we have not sorted ourselves into anything. For us, it does not matter. As long as they are involved with the toilet, they are maintaining it, and they're going and doing it in the community, you can slot us as health and hygiene or education. In fact, we have seen learning outcomes improve by 35 to 40%, because the kids are involved in actually building the system and maintaining it themselves. So we have also seen that increase. But for us, we're using technology to keep a superficial learner happy, and we are mapping the behavior deeper so that we see how we can have a ripple effect. That's why we are that.
Lots of people gaze into their knowledge and it is abandoned. So what we are doing, whatever the money we are receiving from CSR, so we transfer 80% of the funds to the communities. So we form AWAS committees, that's called Association for Water, Sanitation and Hygiene, where the women self-help leaders are forming themselves with the youths and leaders in their village, 10 to 20 members. So we train them and capacitate them and link them with the trained masons and also the cement fabricators, construction materials suppliers, toilet system suppliers. So we transfer the fund to them, to the bank account, opened by the jointly operated. So they are taking the money, they are finding the masons. We train them how to build a cost effective toilet model, quick bit toilet or respite, or EcoSan or SMP tank model. So in that way, we make the community ownership of the project. So they themselves prove that we have done the project. So they are using the toilet. And also we have created the, through the ODF CLTS approach, that the first increase in building, we motivated them to make the community's ODF. One thing. On the behavioral changes, there is a saying in Tamil, complete product of the world. That means habits like what? We cannot change within simply one man's habits. So what we are doing, as Kuldeep was talking about unconscious to conscious like that. So behavior change coming is the system based approach. From unawareness to action, adoption of new behavior, there's a lot of changes involved. So we are educating them through a lot of IEC intervention activities, flashcards, scriptures, take and later again. These are the bad hygiene behaviors, good hygiene behaviors in the third. Through which we are motivating also like that. The third one is child to child approach. We are using. We are educating the children at the field level as well as at the school level. In our adolescent girls program, what we are doing in the menstrual hygiene management program in the schools, we have selected 14 schools where through which we have educated 3,753 girls. Adolescent girls, but each girl after our education on emergency menstrual hygiene management and practices, they in turn teach 5 girls in the villages. So outreach program in that way. And the child to child program is also not only insisting on the school children to use the toilets at the school level, but also motivating their parents to demand for toilet at the household level. These are also some of the hygiene and strategies we are following. Thank you.
We know that any kind of behavior change, as I was mentioning, is extremely hard, and in our case also, when you know that the pregnant mothers are not the decision makers in the family, it's mostly the mother-in-laws, father-in-laws, or even the community. So at our case, we work on 3 layers, right at the individual patient level, at the family level, and then at the community level. And we have also come up with our own app, which is actually measuring the various messaging destination that has various videos, contents, and the users will be able to see the videos. Then we'll be able to see that how much of those videos have been seen, and then that is followed by various self-assessment tests and questionnaires. So that way we'll be able to measure that whatever messaging that we are giving in the community, how much of that has been learned by the community. So that is also being effectively measured. So through these mechanisms, so like in our case, my colleague Manushri has been working on that.
So we have a card, the health card. If I can have your health card, please. So once this health card is screened.
Can you come here? People can see you now.
Yeah.
Just come here.
So this is the health card, and this is the viewer scanner. And once we scan it,
I used to go to class, so you can invest.